Let me say thank you to all the friends and extended family that has come today to support this family. God bless you for coming and being here. We're here to celebrate the homegoing of Samuel Knox. He was born January the 22nd, 1967 in Homerville, Georgia, but he's lived most of part of his life in Waycross. He's lived a few other places, and I'll mention that later in the service, but he was one of five children, and he's next to the youngest. So he passed away on Thursday, the 27th of October, at the hospice house, Satilla, in Waycross. And he was formerly employed with Conley Sheet Metal and was raised in the Church of God faith. He is survived by three children: Coder Beverly of Waycross, Brittany Turner of Jacksonville, and Lance Cox, Tylen of Jacksonville. Seven grandchildren. His parents, the Reverend Shelton and Linda Cox of Waycross. Four siblings: Gail Johnson, Rick of Alma, Everett, Pam of Leesburg, Georgia, Reverend Billy, Deborah of Roanoke, Virginia, and Reverend John and Charlene of Waycross. A half-sister, Lori Thomas, husband Stan of Waycross, and many nieces and nephews. Can we pray at this time? Our precious Father, we again thank you for this day. Thank you for your grace, Lord, that will help us throughout this day, Lord. We lean upon you. We pray for this family as we, Lord, lay them before you today in your care, that they'll find strength and comfort through the Holy Ghost to minister to their hearts. Their hearts are saddened at this time, Lord, but we know that you can give that comfort, Lord, that will bring a smile and can cause rejoicing in time to come, Lord, over a precious loved one that they cared the most for in their life, Lord, a son, a sibling, a dad, a granddad, an uncle, and a friend. And we pray, Father, that you would direct this service here today. Help us to speak those things that would be edifying and uplifting for this family. And look to you for the hope that we have in Christ. We pray, Father, that you would bless the songs, that they might minister to each one's heart that is here, as well as this family. We pray for the message of your word today, that you will give us guidance and the word to speak, Father, that it will bring encouragement and it will cause our thoughts and our minds, Lord, to be centered upon you through Christ, who has given us life in this life. And he's offered it to this whole world, to those that will receive him as their Lord and Savior. Now we pray you go with us and direct all that's done here in this service. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
like to thank each one for coming out and being with us this morning as we celebrate Samuel's life. And we wanted to share some stories as we've gotten together. We shared stories even last night. People were telling me things that made me laugh, and even this morning they were sharing things. And as the boys told stories, I began writing things down because I didn't want them to forget, and I didn't want to forget the stories because they made me smile, because Samuel was one that loved to laugh. And I think everybody can shake their heads to that one. And so I wanted to talk to you and let you understand what that poem was, because in your little flyer. As children, the boys played together, but there was definitely two groups, the big boys and the little boys. That didn't sit well with Samuel when he wanted to do something, like when Everett and Billy refused to share the motorcycle. Back and forth, the two rode in front of the house. Refusing to be left out, Samuel found a shower curtain and filled it with dirt. As the two older siblings drew near, he took aim and, like King David, loosed his projectile and felled his giants. Dad sold that same motorcycle because he was afraid Samuel was going to kill himself on it. Another time, Billy wouldn't share the bicycle. Samuel threw a broomstick into the spokes. You can imagine what happened next. If you can't, ask Billy. Not sure our parents knows about this one, but here goes. The boys made bows from oak limbs, the arrows from dog fennels. They flattened and rolled bottle caps into points to make sharp tips. And yes, they shot at each other with them. One day, Samuel added a corn cob to his arrow. The boys say it hurt. Years later, John and Charlene married and lived with Samuel for a while. One night, John woke to gunfire. When he stepped outside, he found Samuel firing a .22 at the ground. When asked what was he doing, Samuel said, "That cricket is getting on my nerve." When all grew quiet, the cricket chirped again. Something you may not know about Samuel is his love for encyclopedias. His favorite was the letter A, because he loved reading about airplanes. As you think about Samuel in the coming days, I hope you will think about the good times and the laughter. And don't be sad for too long. We know where to find David Samuel Lee. We need only to look inside our hearts. When I think of you, I see the boy staring back at me. Tilted head, slanted grin, warm green eyes, and hands on hips. When I think of you, I see shirtless summers and honeybees. Corncob arrows, oak limb bows, broomsticks inside, bicycle spokes. When I think of you, I see encyclopedias and sweet tea, shower curtain dirt bombs, chirping crickets and midnight guns. When I think of you, I see a lifetime of memories tucked inside this heart of mine, where you'll remain for all time. We love you, Samuel.
I would defend myself. sounded like me and Sammy always had something going against each other. But we were really brothers. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast told me to say, it is well. Should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance that Christ has regarded shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious dawn. My sin, not in part, but the whole. It is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And O Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be signed, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the drum shall resound, and our Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well Samuel sing this morning. This would be his song. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole. It is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, it is well.
Verdict was guilty, case closed, the end. No chance for me to ever leave this prison of my sin. Now I know it might sound crazy, but one day a key unlocked that cell. I heard a small voice say your debt's been paid by somebody else. And now I'm walking, walking. Nothing perfect, I still stumble every single day. I still get knocked down, but the difference now is that's not where I stay. Cause I got a Savior who knows everywhere I've been, and he's telling me that I never have to go back there again. So now I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt, and lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell at my feet. And now I'm walking, walking, walking free, walking free. Walking free.
To the one walking wounded, and to the one with regret, look up and see your victory is just up ahead. Cause there is a Savior who knows everywhere you've been, and he's telling you that you never have to go back there again. So if you know that you never have to go back there again, then sing, I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt, and lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell at my feet. And now I'm walking, walking, walking free, walking free. Walking free, yeah. Oh, I know, I know, I know, I know, I'm walking free, yeah. I'm walking free.
Like that song. Walking free. Are you walking free today? Are you still in bondage? Quite a few weeks ago, he got set free from the bondage that he was in. He was locked in sin's prison. But many weeks back, he was able to break free. Hallelujah. Glory. He's walking free. He doesn't have any more restrictions on his body or soul where he's at right now. He's got a new body that's waiting. This one here is going to take a transformation before long. I believe we've got just a few days before the Lord's coming. I said, I believe we've got a few days before the Lord's coming. Peter said one day with the Lord's like 1,000 years, and he said 1,000 years just like one day. So if you ain't ready, you better get ready. He's waiting. And he's seeking. You can just see Brother Samuel just having himself a time. I tell you, I have myself a time here. Everybody can sit down or they can get up or they can do whatever, but I'm going to have myself a time when I come to the house of the Lord, because I come to meet with him. Not just come and sit and soak. I come and meet with him. Hey, oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm going to have a good time here because I'm getting ready for that time there. So I'm getting a lot of practice here. Amen. I know what I'm going to do when I get there. Amen. Know what's going on. Some of the things going to take place. I believe Samuel's having a glorious time. No restriction, no sickness. I didn't know Samuel as much as I knew Everett, Billy, and John, and Sister Gail. I was around Everett and John and Billy a good bit. Got to know them pretty well. Feel real close to this family. I feel honored to stand up here and speak. Samuel's homegoing service today. And it feels so good. I said it feels good to say it's a homegoing service. You see, I can't preach nobody into heaven. And I can't preach them into hell. There ain't but one man that can take care of that. But I can tell them the one to turn to. I can tell them who they need to look to and what some of the things to expect if we're going. What to look for. Because I'm excited about all that the Lord has. And the things I'm tasting down here, it's going to get better there. And I won't have this old physical body to be limited. I'm going to get to enjoy so much more. And I believe Samuel's having him a time, a great time. And though your sadness and mourning, if you just think about his life, it'll cause you to rejoice that he left here because it was well with his soul. The Lord tells us, in Ezekiel, he said, the soul that sinneth, Ezekiel 18 said, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. It shall die. I'm only planning on if the Lord tarries. Of course, I don't know that that's going to happen. To die one time. I'm not going to die twice. Because the one that has part in the second death is going to be a bad time. It's going to be a bad fate from that on, from then on there. I just plan if the Lord brings me by the way of the grave to die just one time. I'm glad years ago I died to self. And I'm alive unto the Lord today. But if this body falls down, lays down, it'll wait till the Lord comes. But just a few weeks ago I had a missionary said, Brother Knox, I got to give you a word from the Lord. And of course, it's been a number of years since I saw this missionary. Had great respect for him. They do a lot of mission work. And said, the Lord told me two things I want to give you. I said, okay, give it to me. He said, you're going to win a lot of young people to the Lord. I said, I accept that. Let it start today. He said, the second thing is you're going to go in the rapture. I said, I accept that. Amen. If the Lord's coming soon, I accept that. So it very well could be. Now, I might live on another 20 years. I don't know. It might not be but 2 years. But I believe the Lord's coming soon. I think we need to get ready if we ain't ready. Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's a lot of things that I just got tickled at Sister Gail sharing what she shared. And I was told a bunch of things about Samuel, and I want to share a few of those things with you. I'd like to talk about a person's life. I'd like to share the scripture, the word of God, because that's the meat and substance. But I'd like to share about a person's life. Some of the things that they've done. You know, he worked with Conley Sheet Metal for quite some time, worked with Clint Griffin. Clint could tell you a good bit about him. He told me a few things last night about him. But he worked a few places, and he was a pipe fitter. And according to what Clint said, he must have been a super good pipe fitter. He could do his work. I was told a bunch of things by different ones in the family, and I'd like to get you to hear some of them. As Gail was sharing, when he grew up, he was a daredevil. He said he was the daredevil of the family. And he didn't see the danger in doing all kind of stunts. Of course, I reckon sometimes it might have been challenging to Everett or John or Billy, but Samuel was going to do it. He set his side on doing it, so he was going to do it. Now, they said no matter if you give him toys or things that you give him, he'd take them apart just to see how it was made. Then he'd put it back together. I don't remember if it was the first bike or second bike John said they got. Said, next thing you knew, he had it apart, just working on it. But he went to fixing it and making a roaster out of it. Had to put him an extender out on the front tire of it, you know, so he could do him some daredevil acts. Jump him some bumps and whatever. But he liked working with his hands and doing things. Taking stuff apart, putting it back together. Of course, I can identify with that as young boys, and you're inquisitive about certain things. You want to know what makes something work and how it works. But I didn't get into all that, taking everything apart that was given to me. They said Samuel, he'd tear it apart. Sister Linda said even when he moved into houses and got cars, he'd done the same thing. Said he had a car, he had to fix it his way. It'd be running, you know, fine, but he's going to go through it and change everything to make it work his way. Go into a house, he said he wanted to do the same thing. He wanted that house to be the way he wanted it. So he'd make a lot of changes in the house. So he was a doer. But he was pretty funny. And a jokester, according to a good bit that some of them said. Brother Shelton said that he thought he had that ADHD. Said he had it pretty bad. Brother Shelton said, I think I've got some of it too. Sister Linda said he was meticulous about his dress, the way he dressed. Said Samuel was the only one that she had to buy Levi's for. Said he wouldn't wear plain the pockets. You know, they'd go out to Pick and Save and buy the plain pockets. And Samuel, that wasn't for him. He had to have the Levi's because they fit him closer and made him look, I guess, better, you know. So it wasn't just going to be any way, but Billy and Everett and John, they had to go with plain pockets. So I guess sometimes you do get the, you know, preferred treatment once in a while. So that was one of the things that he had to have, the way he dressed. Brother Shelton was telling me how For many years, he'd worked in the bee business. And I'd think about it, I'd come up working too some in the bee business. A man that lived in front of us in the community where I grew up at, his son was almost my age, and we would help him in the bee business. He had a bee house and sold honey and stuff, but I got tickled at Brother Shelton. He'd say, at certain times of the seasons, the bees wouldn't sting you. And he said they had, John said it was a bee goat. Said they'd take and put it on some material or whatever, fabric, and they'd put it on top of the box. And said that was the stinkiest stuff. That it worked towards the bees, but he said if you got it on you, said nobody wouldn't be around you, it stunk. But when they'd be out there messing with the bee boxes, and Samuel would take his shirt off. And he'd do it constantly, but, you know, different times, I guess, and seasons. He'd take his shirt off out there working around bees. And I can only imagine now, someone out working around bee boxes and with their shirt off, and I think how crazy they are. You know, how many times they're going to get stung? But he wouldn't get stung, Brother Shelton said. He wouldn't be stung. But see, they always have his shirt off. You know, I'd say, yeah, I could just see people riding by thinking, that boy's crazy. Look what he's doing. You know, working around a lot of bee boxes and getting the honey out of it. He's going to be stung all over his body. But I know the honey house I worked in for a while, I'd get stung quite often at times, and I didn't like it. Brother Shelton had a flatbed truck, they said, that he hauled his bee boxes on and moved them from place to place. And Billy had got old enough to get his license, and so he started driving, I think, to school. And so it was Billy driving, and John was in the middle because he was the baby. He was the youngest, and Samuel was on the other side. And Samuel didn't like the way the bee truck looked. And so before they'd get right up close to the school, you know how they all pull up close to the school and unload, he'd say, hold up. He said, stop and let me out here. He said, Billy, I said now, stop and let me out here. He said, Billy, just keep on driving. Because he didn't want to drive up in that old truck, that old ugly work truck, bee truck, in front of everybody, you know, with other automobiles and stuff, and then him get out. He said, I'm going to get you when I get home. I could just see that, you know, carrying on. I know what it's like. He's talking about brothers. You could fight one another and do tricks on one another. I had 7 brothers, and we could do that on each other. In fact, there'd be times we'd think we want to knock one another out, and my dad said, all right, get the gloves on, put the boxing gloves on, so you won't, and you can't punch one another in the nose, and you can't go too low below the belly. But we'd hit a few licks, and one got hit the hardest, we'd stop. So I know what it was like fighting a little bit, you know, with brothers, but we wouldn't let others jump on one another. But Samuel was a cut up, pulling pranks and doing things and making people laugh. And I'm sure there's a lot of you that in the family and friends, if you knew him very well, you'll think about things and you'll laugh about it. How he pulled a prank or something that he done. You'll reminisce about and it'll make your heart glad. But it's good. It's good to love and to be loved. And I believe he come from a home that loved him. And he loved his parents and his siblings. He loved them back and his family. And he was always missing for years, always missing a big spot in his heart. Until many weeks back, he found a real true love through Jesus Christ. And he turned his life over to him. Brother Billy was blessed. I told Brother Billy, I said, I was making my plans to go see him because when I got news about his sickness and all, I wanted to go see him too and talk to him. And Brother Billy had got to him and he'd told him, he said, that he'd been talking to the Lord and made things right with the Lord. So what a blessing that is. Another time he was there in the hospital, and John said he was there talking with Samuel. And he told Samuel, Samuel went to get up. And of course he had been weak in his body. And John said, wait a minute. He said, Samuel, you ain't no spring chicken. And he said, well, I ain't no slow cow neither. I don't know where that come from, you know. Slow cow or an old cow. And they said, I ain't no old cow neither, you know. You ain't no spring chicken. Clint told how he worked there with Conley. Said he could work, and said they'd have pipes and all to run, and he said Samuel would start out and said he could make some time. Said now he was a worker, and he was very good at his work. I reckon he was meticulous enough to take apart something and had patience with it and put it back together just to see how it works or what's what about it. That surely he was good with his hands and doing pipe fitting. It seemed to be a good trade that he must have been well at, done a good job and enjoyed doing it. And I know he lived here in Waycross, Ware County for many years, and he moved down to Folks and lived down there for quite a few years, and I think in Jacksonville. Said for a while, Sister Linda said he went out to Cody, Wyoming, lived out there for 6 months or so. So he'd been around a few places instead of just being in Ware County. I remember talking to a lady several years ago, and she said she pretty much stayed all her life in Ware County. Said she hadn't been, too adventurous to go out and go beyond Ware County. I said, well, I reckon that's all right. If you're content with that, that's okay. I said, I'm comfortable staying in South Georgia. The Lord will leave me alone, I'll stay down in South Georgia and do his work for him if he'll allow me. But he got to go around places and be with people, made friends. Now, he was quiet. I noticed that when I become acquainted with the family, with the whole Cox family. He was quiet, that he didn't say a whole lot. You were talking with some in the family or something. But now when you got one-on-one with him and begin to talk. Now, he could talk. But if you weren't talking directly to him and one-on-one, he'd just listen and just look. And he probably wouldn't stand there too long. He'd go off and do something else while you was talking. But Clinton said he got to turning in the paper to Elizabeth Spradley that worked there in the office with Conley. And said he'd write on the work orders, turn them in, he'd put Samuel. And she'd say, Clinton said, you got his name spelled wrong. And he said, no, I ain't got his name spelled wrong. He said, that's a Samuel there. He said he can lift a lot and carry a lot. And said, yeah, said he can carry his own weight. He said, he's a Samuel. He's not Samuel. But you know, you think about good things and life. And it sounded like that Samuel did enjoy life, but I believe once he came to the Lord and experienced what it was like to have a personal Lord and Savior, oh, what a joy. What a joy that he began to experience that he never experienced before. Today, something about a new relationship with Christ. There's something about that relationship with Him that is different than any relationship we have while we're on this earth with any person or in any family or anything. There's something different about that relationship, Sister Gail. Sister Linda, there's something different about that relationship. I have a close-knit family. We love one another. Close. I've lost two brothers. They was 8 boys and 3 girls. And we love each other and have close fellowship with one another. But there's a deeper, greater fellowship with the Lord that I have. That's unlike anything I've had with my family. And I love them dearly. And I believe that I'd give my life for them to live if it was needful. I love them that much. But I know one thing, I'll give my life for the Lord. If he wants me to give my life for him. Because you see, he gave his life for me. He laid his life down for me, and he didn't have to. But he did. He did it because he loved me. And we're told Ecclesiastes, the 3rd chapter, verse 1 and 2, says that everything, there's a season. And there is a season to everything. And he said a time to every purpose. He said there's a time to be born. And there's a time to die. Now I begin to think about a time being born. And the Lord gave me this to equate this with the message here today about being born again and what the Lord is doing for you and me. And I was thinking about a new child, you know. Couple gets married and they're going to have a baby. Oh, they're preparing for a soon coming baby. Now you listen to some of these things. Well, the wife begins to change some eating habits. She usually puts on a little extra weight. She has to alter some of her clothes. Every few weeks, doctor visits occur. Another room in the house gets painted, usually decorated. They're buying baby beds and baby totes and strollers and clothes and diapers. And maybe what kind of formula they're going to use unless they breastfeed the baby. Then after the arrival of the baby, they have to add them to their insurance policy. And then the spending begins to change for the family. That's what happens. Because see that little fella, that little girl, when they get here and they pick up on it real quick, they learn how to say, "Me." You can't hear it. You think they're crying. If you listen real close, it's "me." You know? And boy, when you run to them, they learn how to keep doing that. And they'll call you to them over and over and over. And you'll change your spending. You'll change the way you spend your money. Yeah, you'll do it. You make a lot of changes for the family to bring them up. The cost of raising up a child and having a family. Well, when we die, there's a plan just to say goodbye. No. We'll make arrangements like we've done today for Samuel. And we'll say our goodbyes. There'll be this type of service or memorial service. And of course, we pick out a plot to where to put them at or whether or not they're cremated. And if we can take just a few moments and think back, especially as adults, to when you were born, you can think back 20, 30, 40, 60, 70, maybe some of you might be 80 or older in here. Years, you can think back on it in just a moment. And think about your life and where you've come from. What all your life has been involved in. All the years to this present day. But do you ask yourself, where am I headed? Where am I going? What is my need? What's the most important need in my life? What is the one most important thing that I need to do? The change that needs to take place in me that no one else can do for me but me alone. No one else can change anything in my life but me. Like the old saying, you lead the horse to water, you can't make him drink. And somebody say, yeah, well, you can put some salt or whatever you can in his food. But you can't make a person serve the Lord. It has to be a desire that I'm tired and sick of the way I used to live or pleasantly living, and I want to be free from that bondage. I want to get out of that bondage. It's like that song, that last song we heard. Being made free. I want to be freed from that. And the only one can set you free from the bondage of sin is the Lord Jesus Christ. When you repent of your sins and ask Him to forgive you. And you know, forgiveness is a powerful word. There's not but one word that's any stronger than the word forgiveness. And you can go home and look up and you can write down anything you want to and think about the word forgiveness. That's powerful. There ain't but one word that's greater than the word forgiveness. Because as a child of God, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for forgiveness. You wouldn't be here as a child of God if it wasn't for forgiveness. You wouldn't have the relationship that you have if it wasn't for forgiveness of God through His Son, Jesus. And there ain't but one thing greater than that word forgiveness, and that's His love. That's His love that brought about the means of me being forgiven. For Him to lay His life down for me and for you. Amen. Amen. How powerful that is. To be forgiven. You know, when you're forgiven, all that was against you is blotted out. Amen. I preached a few Sundays back here. I said about the goodness of God. God is so good to us to give us the next breath and the next breath and another day. But I tell you what, He's not only a God of goodness and of mercy, but He's a God of wrath and a God of judgment. He means what He says in His Word. Amen. He means every bit of what He says in His Word. And we think about what's the most important thing to my life measured on this scale. Is it something physical? Is it something financial? Is it something material? Or would it be something spiritual for your life? We're told in Mark, the 8th chapter, in verse 34, said, when He had called the people unto Him with His disciples also, He said unto them. Now this is Jesus speaking as Mark records about the cost of discipleship. Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. That's not hard to do. It's not a hard thing to do if you give your all to it. If you surrender all to Him. But if you don't want Him to have all that you are, you're going to have a struggle and a fight. And you're not going to let Him win for you because you're trying to win. You're trying to do it your way, and it ain't going to work. He said, whosoever will save his life, I'm going to do my best to protect myself. I'm going to keep myself from doing this or that. Yeah, you ain't going to do a whole lot as you think you will. He said, whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life, die to self, die out, so that Christ may live within you. That he will lose his life, he said, for my sake and the gospel, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? What treasures are you seeking for today? What are you hoping to gain today in this world, in this life? Is it like old Rockefeller that said many years ago when I was watching him with Larry King live some 28, 30 years ago, he said, what will make you happier? He said, just a little more. I'll tell you what will make me happier. A little more of God. A little more of his love. Amen. A little more of my surrendered obedience to his will for him to work in my life and use me. Or for him to work in your life and use you. He said, what will a man give in exchange? What do you think you can bargain with God and give him? One day we're going to stand before him. He's either going to be a savior or a judge. And you ain't going to be able to argue your case on that day. You ain't going to be able to say, he's going to be the speaking. He's going to do it. You ain't going to be able to do it. And it's either going to be entering into the joys of the Lord. Amen. I have a reward for you. Or to be depart from me, I never knew you. He said in verse 38, he said, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me. Are you ashamed of the Lord today? Is that why you're not serving him? If you're not saved, are you ashamed of him? He said, if you're ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, he said, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Well, he wants us to know in his word. He wants us to know in Matthew 9 and 6 that he hath power on earth to forgive our sins. But we have to ask. I have to ask him. You have to ask him. Jesus said in Luke 19 and 10, he said, for the Son of Man has come to seek. See, he's trying this very day. He is trying his best to seek out souls that don't know him. He's come to seek and save. He said that which was lost. So now guess what? I talked about the baby. All the activity comes with a new baby coming. You see, Jesus is being active. Just like the new baby that's coming into the family. He's being active right now. He's seeking. He is doing anything he can to seek the lost. He's trying to make preparation. And when you are born again, when you become a child of God, just like that baby, when that baby comes out of that womb and all the activity that takes place from that point on, well, when you become born again, oh, he's getting you a gown that's ready. He's getting you a robe that's going to be put on you. Amen. It's being prepared in his glory, in his heaven. And there's a lot of things he said in John 14. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and then I'm going to come again and receive you into myself. That where I am, there you may be also. What's the most important need in your life? What is it? Jesus said in Mark 1 and 15, he said that we're to repent and believe the gospel. Pretty simple, ain't it? Pretty simple. Then I want to close with Luke 13. Luke 13. Somebody says, well, preacher, pastor, I've been too bad. You have. Well, he specializes in bad boys, bad girls. He specializes in them. He can help you make a change. This is his call to repentance that he says in Luke 13, verse 1, said, there were present at that season, some that told him of the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answered, said unto them, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans because they suffered such things. He said, no, except ye repent. Except ye repent. ye shall all likewise perish. And then he said, or of those 18 upon whom the tower of Siloam had failed and slew them, you think they were sinners that were above all men that dwelled in Jerusalem? He said, no, I tell you, they weren't. They weren't sinners above all. They weren't the most wicked because of their evil doings or whatever they done. It didn't make them that there was a good sinner and a bad sinner. There ain't no such thing. You either a sinner, you either lost or saved. It's black or white. There's no gray. He said, nay, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Now, I've said these words today because I don't know who of you in here are saved and who's not saved. But as a minister of the gospel, I believe that when we have an opportunity to share at a time like this, it's so important to think about where you are and where you're headed. Do you know where you're headed today? A good friend of mine in Tennessee, pastoring up there. Some of you know Anthony, Cain and Judy. And Mama's stepdad was coming back home, wasn't too far from home, and was hit head on by a drunk driver. She lived a little while and passed away. Lee is still in ICU. Said, we don't know. We get in the cars and we're going to take a trip. We don't know how short our time is. But I tell you what we can know. We can know where we're going when we leave here. I don't know how I'm going to leave here. And I don't know where I'm going to be at when I leave here. And if that prophecy was given to me by that missionary that I'm going to leave here in the rapture, I said, I accept that and I'm looking for that to take place. Amen. I'm ready to go when the Lord's ready. I want my family, and I got a lot of them that's lost. And you may have a lot in your family that's lost, but what are we doing? What are we doing with the work of the gospel? See, this world, all of our world leaders and government and so much of our government, politicians, so much as so against Christianity. They ain't against religion. They're against Christianity. Why? Because it's one of a kind. It's only one way to the Father. There ain't many ways or any way. There ain't but one way, and that's through the Lord Jesus Christ. And they fought all through the ages and the centuries, and they're still fighting today. And you know, I pray for them. I really do. I pray for all of our leaders in our country and our local leaders, those that's not saved, God save them. They need to know who Jesus Christ is, need to be saved. Because I believe he's coming back. And those that aren't ready is going to face the devil's hell. And that's just going to be the beginning of sorrows. Ain't going to be. We might have sorrows here. Don't know what we're going to face before we leave here, but I tell you, that's going to be the beginning where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth, chewing on one another, forever in torment. Don't sound like a good picture, preacher. I don't think it is. I don't want to experience it. I don't plan to go there. I'm planning a way of escape. I was rescued, and I want to hold on to that rescue line and don't let go. He's going to take me to be with him. I want him to take you also to be with him. But only you can make that decision. Whatever is the most important need in your life, that's what you're going to pursue. I believe that. Whatever's the most important need in your life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. that this family can sit here today. Lord, with a joy in their hearts, knowing we're their son, their brother, their dad, uncle, nephew is going to be, cousin is going to be. Thank you, Lord, because we got that hope. We've got that hope through your word. And Paul said if we didn't have that hope of his word in this life, we'd be of all men most miserable, and we sure would be. But thank God we got that hope. Praise the Lord. David, when he lost his baby with him and Bathsheba, he'd wept on his couch, his bed all night, and fasted. And the baby died through the night before sunrise, and so the next morning some went in and told David, said, the child's gone. And David went and washed his face and changed his garments. He rose up and he said, he can't come back to me, but he said, I can go. Oh, I can go to be where he is. I've got some loved ones too that's gone on. Brother Shelton, I believe they went to the right place. I believe they did. And I'm looking to go to the right place. We can go there if we want to. No one can stop you. Because greater is he that's in you, Jesus Christ, than Satan and all his imps in this world try to hinder you and stop you from going. Because you can make it. Brother Billy, you're going to come. We're going to close and having a... It's a good thing that I was the only speaker, wasn't it? Where are you going to go? It's Saturday. It's early. It's just a few minutes after 11. Still a while before gun smoke comes on. In the meantime, we're going to get to have food in the back with the family. And we invite you to stay in fellowship with us if you will. But we've got a song we want to close with. Amazing Grace. Isn't God's grace amazing? Have you found his grace amazing today? Yesterday? Sister Linda, his grace is amazing. So amazing that when Samuel cried out to him all the years that you and your family, Brother Shelton, has prayed for him to be saved. Went through this sickness and didn't know that in this sickness he was going to come alive to be able to live forevermore. Amen. In receiving Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. Would you stand with me? Let's sing. Sister Gail, are you good at leading Amazing Grace? Billy, you gonna lead it? Go
Amazing
ahead.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Thank you.
Dangers stole.
Said, let everything that have breath praise him. He said, if we don't praise him, he said, the rocks will cry out. Woo! God, I'm going to praise you. I ain't going to get my blessing. Hallelujah. Not going to get my blessing. Amen. I believe right now, in the paradise where Samuel's gone to, where other saints that have left this place, this world, they're praising, rejoicing. Amen. Singing hallelujahs and glories. Praise the Lord. Amen. Ain't no sad day there. There's sadness here in losing him. But like David, he's not going to come back here unless the Lord chooses to do so. He could. But we can go be where Sister Deborah, he's at. We can go to that place that other loved ones, your dad's gone. Other loved ones is gone. Amen. I want to see the one that made it all possible. Oh, I'm looking to see Jesus. I'm looking to see him.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. I tell you, when I fell in love with that man, I've been loving him more ever since. I can't get enough of his love. I sure love my dad and mom and siblings, but I'm telling you, I can't get enough of that man's love. That's a great love. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He loves you, and he's out seeking to save you if you're not saved. God bless you today. I pray this has been all right. It's been okay because it's already happened. So you can't do nothing now. It's done happened. I pray for you, family. I pray for you that God will strengthen you and you'll find your walk with him begin to just magnify and grow. And if you're not saved, I pray that you will become saved. As he knocks on your heart's door, you're the one that holds the key. You open it and let him come in. Amen. Father, we ask you, Lord, to go with us now as we go across the road and to the burial site. We just pray, Lord, that you continue to comfort hearts here. Pray your spirit continue to direct, Lord.
minister to the needs that are here in your house today. Minister to your children. Bless your children. Heavenly Father, we ask through Christ and through the Holy Ghost.